I think Kate is gonna do a roving mic. If there are questions, raise your hand so Kate can hand you a mic.
Hello. My question is, how would it be to help political parties to run open source in their offices? Because obviously some of them don't, and they're even propagating using open source.
Yeah. Many political parties in the Netherlands, they tend to be very small IT shops themselves and very underfunded. So if you volunteer to help with their IT, usually they will welcome you with open arms because they're always short of manpower, especially sort of, you know, actually professional IT people. So it's fairly easy to just basically volunteer to help them. And then, you know, if you have a little bit of expertise, very soon you can help them think out, you know, how the next sort of evolution of their IT will be. So it's basically a matter of volunteering and helping out. But it also means that you have to get down to the nitty-gritty stuff of, you know, switching over an office environment from, you know, whatever they have to maybe an open environment, which is quite a tricky job. It's not necessarily easy if they have financial applications and software to run, you know, their membership registry, which may be 12-year-old and running only on a certain version of Windows. And so it's not an easy process, but it's very worthwhile to start it. And in the process of doing it, you actually create awareness with a lot of people that this is more than just a technical issue. It's a political issue. So you help to politicize more people on it.
Well, so I asked some parties, well, do you run open source, which you propagate? And they say, well, we should think about it. So there is willingness, but
The way to do it is to actually go there and help one specific group. It can also be like a local political group in a city, which tend to be smaller and sort of less complex in terms of organization. But you have to actually go there and do it for them, not just a theory. So hands on.
And maybe get some money from NLNet to do it professional.
Yeah, well, they could maybe support people who would willing to do that. Absolutely, yeah. Any other questions?
Hello.
Hi.
I don't know if it's a problem here in the Netherlands, but have you fought against data retention laws and criminalization of hacking tools and stuff like that? Because from there was a treaty in Bulgaria in 2001 that implements. That derived, it's from where it's derived all the things like the Ripper Act in England.
I'm sorry, I can't hear you. Please speak a little bit slower and maybe point the microphone away from the speaker.
In Bulgaria in 2001, there was a treaty that was about cybercrime and everything.
Yeah.
And for the whole Europe, you have like data retention and criminalization of the hacking tools. And so on. I don't know if it's a problem here in the Netherlands, if you are aware of it.
In the Netherlands, hacking tools are still legal. They're also used by the Dutch government a lot for all kinds of purposes. I know in Germany they have been made illegal, but I don't think that a lot of companies actually use them, sort of stick to that rule.
Yes, because now, no one is still enforcing the laws, but if they are made, like they were made in Germany, in England, now they're going to be made in Portugal and in other countries of the EU. Because it's an EU regulation, it will spread across the whole Europe.
It might, if we don't do something about it, then yeah, so that will be made a political issue. You know, can you make software illegal or can you make knowledge about software illegal? Because, of course, software can always be recreated if you know that something can be done. I think making certain types of software illegal is probably something like making certain drugs illegal. It's been done in many countries, and it has, without exception, failed, both in the real world and in actually achieving any goal. So then probably the things will go away after a while. But we have to protest it every step of the way, because otherwise it's going to go further.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Hello. I was quite concerned to hear that Microsoft was preventing people from using their software in a specific way. But I noticed that the user license was 2004, yeah? I don't know if you were... I mean, I know I can just find out by reading all the Microsoft's user licenses and stuff, but hopefully you're aware of whether or not they are still doing that or whether or not they've been embarrassed out of it. Would you know?
I know for a fact that within government, up until recently, they didn't. The governments didn't really study the license. So what we do is we would study them and then point out things to them. Yeah. So for instance, in the original Windows Vista license, when it just came out, it says very clearly that if you are a professional user, you cannot comment negatively about the product in a public forum.
Yeah.
So what that meant basically that if you're a civil servant and you're using Windows Vista and you think it's crap, which you know might
you're not
happen,
allowed to say so.
then you can't actually say that in a public forum. Mm. Now, then there was a lot of protest about that part of the license across the world, and so Microsoft changed it. But if you can convince legal professionals to actually read those documents, they will either cry or laugh very hard, but they will certainly do something. Because some of the stuff is in there that is, it's just draconian and it's bizarre. Yeah. Often it's also just not legal.
Yeah.
So they say, for instance, we reserve the right to change these conditions retroactively. Mm. That it's that sort of thing is actually in the contract. That you're, so they say, we reserve the right to change this contract from our side without telling you going back in time until the time that you purchased it. Now, if you make legal professionals within organizations aware of those kinds of conditions, then they will look at the software with a very different sort of eye.
Sure.
So, but yes. You have to convince them to actually read it.
Yeah. Thanks.
Anybody else? Thank you.
Thanks. It's just a quick question, picking up on the last but one question about criminalisation of certain activities. Could you say a little brief word about the case of Gary McKinnon and similar provisions in the Netherlands?
All right. Well, it's a bit of a tangent, but there is a British a hacker who in 2001 and 2002 actually accessed a whole bunch of US defence and NASA systems. He claims he was looking for information about UFOs or something like that. And he is about to be extradited to the U.S. to serve 70 years in some sort of black hole type prison. It probably won't be Guantanamo Bay because supposedly they're closing that, but it will be something else. It is funny that in the U.K., the local authorities didn't consider what he did important enough to even take the trial. So in the UK, he would have gotten off with a fine or maybe, 100 hours of community service. But then the US came in and says, look, this guy is very dangerous and evil. And he said, look, I just pointed out that most of your Pentagon computers didn't have a password on it. So he might be extradited to the US where they will do God knows what to him. It's a bit tricky these days to know what goes on there in the cellars. That is a bit of a scary thought, because you can do things that are nominally legal or not that illegal here in Europe, thinking you will be defended by your government, which you elected to defend you against this sort of crap, and then it turns out that somebody from across the Atlantic can just pick up a phone and order you to be delivered into their hands, and then what happens? I mean, this is, for me, precisely the kind of crap. I hire my government to defend me against that sort of stuff. And if they don't, then there's a real problem. That is an interesting case.